A simple matter for a big God. A simple matter for a big God. How do we explain the supernatural? What do you say when the phenomenal out of the ordinary occurs? Things that don't make sense to our finite minds. When the miraculous takes place, what can you say? You see, we live in a world where men and their philosophies and ideologies and scientific methodologies attempt to explain away the supernatural activity of our cosmic God. We, as his people, we can simplify it and just declare with the psalmist over in Psalm 64 when he said, "And all men shall reverently fear and be in awe. They will declare the work of God, for they will wisely consider and acknowledge that it is his doings." That's what we explain when you see a healing that the doctor had written off and God comes in to heal. And when God opens up a way that seemed impossible, we don't have to try to come up with any explanation except to say that it was God's doing. Am I right today? Now, so God, I believe, is moving in such a way that all will just have to declare that this is of the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our sight. As I suggested to you earlier in this text, we will see and we will show forth the miraculous doings of the Lord and how he operates supernaturally to bless his people. It's a great story. It's a great story. You go back to verse number 4 there, and it says that the king of Moab raised sheep, and he was forced to give the king of Israel 100,000 lambs and another 100,000 rams. But when Ahab died, the king of Moab rebelled against the king of Israel. So King Joram set out from Samaria and prepared Israel for war. His first move was to send a message to Jehoshaphat, king of Judah. "The king of Moab has rebelled against me. Would you join me and fight him?" Verse 7, "I'm with you all the way," said Jehoshaphat. "My troops are your troops. My horses are your horses. Which route shall we take?" "Through the badlands of Edom." Verse 9 says, "The king of Israel, the king of Judah, and now the king of Edom started out on what proved to be a looping detour." Now understand here that they started on this journey, and as they were going, they encountered a problematic situation. The route took them through the desert. The route took them through the desert, and they ran into a water problem. Now, they experienced a period of dryness. That's a serious predicament, am I right? Now, they were nowhere near water, and do you not know you can start on your course of victory, and you can hit a dry season? Do I have anybody? Anybody ever been through a dry season? You were going well. You were on your way. Things were working out. You had in sight the vision. You had the end in sight, but you hit a dry spell. You hit a dry season. This was a desperate situation, and they found themselves in a place where the only way out was that a miracle had to occur. It was a matter for a big God. They didn't have water for the men. They didn't have water for the animals. And they had been on the journey several days. And they needed this big God to step in. Is there anybody this morning who's in a situation and you need God to step in? You need God. You need this big God that we're talking about to step in. You need a miracle. Now, so we understand then that their victory would be of the Lord's doing. Now, somebody is there right now. The only way you're going to get through it is that it has to be a miracle, because maybe you hit a dry season where you need a miracle. Maybe you're in a dry place this morning. You have a need for a blessing and a breakthrough. Maybe it's in your family. Maybe it's concerning your health. Maybe it's in your finances. Maybe it's in your walk with God that you've sort of hit a dry season. But you are determined, I'm not going to get stuck in this dry season, because I serve a mighty God, and God doesn't want me to live in a dry season. Isn't that right? Now, we understand then that when you find yourself in a place like that, it depends on what your prior experiences have been as to how you will respond. Because every now and then, everybody hits a season. Every now and then, everybody hits a trial. Everybody hits a potential struggle. But it depends on what's going on in your life as to how you respond to that season. Isn't that right? I read over in Romans where it talked about in the 8th chapter that those who are after the flesh mind the things of the flesh, but those who are after the Spirit mind the things of the Spirit. Now look at the text here, and we discover now that the king in verse 10, look at verse 10. The king of Israel said, bad news. God has gotten us three kings out here to dump us into the hand of Moab. Isn't that something? In that flesh, have you ever seen folk that as soon as a challenge arises, as soon as there seems like a little turbulence, they start shouting, bad news, bad news, bad news. Everything's gone down. That was because this was the son of Ahab, and they were the worshipers of Baal, and he was fleshy, and he saw this as an opportunity for God to destroy the three kings, and so he saw it as doom and gloom. He panicked, and he saw nothing but a tragic end. He operated from a carnal perspective because he had a form of godliness, but he denied the power therein. See, when you operate from the flesh, then your response in trouble will be that which is derived from the flesh. For the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. And so here is a man who walked in fear and who didn't trust God, and yet he was leading the people. And as soon as he encountered trouble, he saw it as a decline and an end. But look at verse number 11. Thank God that there was another man of God there. Jehoshaphat said, isn't there a prophet of God anywhere around through whom we can consult God? You got to get around some people that even when it looks like trouble hits, you got to be around some people who are ready to say, wait a minute, let's see what God said. Let's don't write ourselves off. Let's don't cast ourselves aside. We need to know what God can do in our situation. You got to be careful who you're hanging out with, who's speaking into your life, who's talking over you, because sometimes you lose all your hope, you lose all your joy, because you're around a whole lot of naysayers. You're around a whole lot of people that when you run into something, when you face something, the only thing they can say is, child, I don't know about you, but I would just give up. It seems too bad. But is there anybody here who says, I got to be selective about who I'm hanging with? I need to hang with some people that I don't care what you see. I don't care how difficult it looks. I don't care what the challenge is. You can say that God has a word for our situation. Look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, God has a word for your situation. Jehoshaphat said, hold on, wait a minute. Let's see what God said. Let's consult God. And then in that 11th verse, one of the servants of the king of Israel said, Elisha, the son of Shaphat, is around somewhere, and he is the one who was Elijah's right-hand man. And Jehoshaphat said, good. A man we can trust. So the three of them, the king of Israel, Jehoshaphat, and the king of Edom, went to meet him. Now, So we understand here then that Jehoshaphat said, we got to get a prophetic word. Now, I'm in a situation now. I don't need the signs of economic indicators. I don't need the wisdom of the day. I need to know, is there a word from the Lord? Somebody came this morning and you came and you were in a situation. You got something that's backed up. You got something that's dry in your life, and you don't need to hear what the weathermen are saying. You don't need to hear what Wall Street is saying. You don't need to hear even what the president is saying, Congress is saying. I need a word from God, because God's word is going to be for my life. Now, so they come to Elijah, verse number 13. Elijah walks up, and you got the king of Israel, who was the son of the wicked king Ahab and Jezebel, and you got Jehoshaphat and the king of Edom. Now, Elijah addressed the king of Israel as soon as he walked up. He said, what do you and I have in common? He said, go consult the puppet prophets of your father and your mother. Huh? See, they have been Baal worshipers. And when King Ahab died, then his son came on the throne, and the man of God said, wait a minute, why are you even here in front of me? And so the king of Israel said, never. It's God who has gotten us into this fix, dumping all three of us kings into the hand of Moab. Even there's some folk. That even when somebody tries to bring you into a right mindset, even when they say, listen, we don't panic, let's trust God, there's some people who still keep talking what the enemy's saying. I told you earlier that you can't take any thought of what the enemy is saying, because whenever you take the thought that the enemy's saying, you will know it because you begin to repeat it. Huh? You didn't cast it down, and so the king of Israel didn't cast it down. He accepted that the enemy was whispering in his ear that you have encountered this situation, and it's God that's going to take you out. I got to tell somebody that you got to hear Jesus when he said, every sickness is not unto death. I wish I could get somebody. Every situation is not in here to take you out. Everything you encounter is not to take you down. Is there anybody here today? And so he goes on, and verse number 14 and 15, Elijah said, as God of the angel armies lives, and before whom I stand ready to serve, he said, if it weren't for the respect I have for Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, I wouldn't give you the time of day. My God, that man must have been something else. He said, if it were not for the fact that Jehoshaphat was a part of the delegation, he said, I wouldn't even look your way. My God. So that tells me that there was some favor with Jehoshaphat. Favor is having delight in, to incline, or to be generous to. It's good to have the favor of God on your side. Am I right? Things happen when you have the favor of God. I can't get anybody. And you ought to want to live your life so much so that God will honor and recognize that I have favored you. That's what Jehoshaphat was. Jehoshaphat was favored by God. And let me tell you something. You need to make sure you connect with some people who are favored by God. And whenever you are favored by God, God will cause some supernatural things to happen. I remember reading in Exodus chapter number 3 and verses 19 through 22, and whenever the people were getting ready to leave Egyptian captivity, and he says, I knew the king of Egypt would not let you go unless compelled by a mighty hand. He said, I will stretch my hand and strike Egypt with all my wonders that I will perform in it, and after that he will let you go. I will bring this people into such favor with Egyptians, you will not go out empty-handed. Each woman shall ask her neighbor and any woman living in the neighbor's house for jewelry of silver, of gold, of clothing. He says that you shall spoil Egypt and ask and receive. In other words, God says that even though they have been in Egyptian captivity over 400 years, and now he has secured their release, he said, I'm favoring you so much so that you're not going to leave empty-handed. I wish I could get somebody who could rejoice and say, I don't know what you've been through. I don't know what storm you've come out of. I don't know what situation you have encountered, but God can so favor you that he would declare that you have been in, but I'm bringing you out, and I'm bringing you out, and I'm favoring you. You're not getting ready to go out empty-handed. It might have been difficult. It might have been burdensome, but whatever it is, God, this big God, somebody say this big God. This big God said, I will favor you. Now, what is it that causes favor? It's when you delight yourself in the Lord. Proverbs 3, 1 through 4 says, my son, do not forget my law, but let your heart keep my commands. For length of days and long life and peace they will add to you. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. And so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. Is there anybody who could stand to have a little favor with God and man? My God, when you got favor with God and man, listen, you don't even have to worry. You might not have enough money in your pocket, but the favor with God and man will cause you to be able to go in and through some things that otherwise you would have been denied. As a matter of fact, there's some folk right now, you know that if the truth be told, that you never really qualified for what you're walking in right now, but it was just a favor of God. My God, you had received reject letter after reject letter. You have been denied over and over. And then God said, listen, I am going to favor you, and I'm going to cause them to open this door unto you. I'm going to cause them to give you the job, even though you didn't have the full qualification. I'm going to call you to get that promotion, even though you didn't have all of your papers in order. But God can favor you. And when you got the favor of God, that's wonderful. And God will cause man to favor. Is there anybody who says, I need the favor of God and man? Well, you got to delight yourself in the Lord. All right? And so Jehoshaphat was the one that was favored. And thank God, sometimes, you know, when you're trying to get your own self together, you better hang out with some folk with favor. Huh? Hey, listen. It would have been a shame if the king of Israel had gone out by himself to Elijah. Elijah said, I wouldn't even look your way. My God, there's some stuff that's going to come on you. You're saying, I don't have it all together yet. I'm still kind of walking and it's a little shaky. But because you're going to hook up with the right person, God is going to still cause favor. I don't have anybody. And I believe this morning that God is preparing a move that when it's done, you will have to declare that it's the Lord's doing and it is marvelous in our sight. And so we understand the reason that Elijah was so rough with Jehoram was that he was not a godly leader. But because of the favor on Jehoshaphat, God was going to move. Now, listen, you got to understand that you're in a good season. You're in a good season for the favor of God. I want you to understand that even in the midst of doubters and scoffers and even those that you may hang out with who like to see everything you do fail, but you just declare to them, that's all right, you might look at me like this now, but favor is on me. As a matter of fact, I'm going to grab that word right out of Psalm 102 and 13 where it says, thou shalt arise and have mercy on Zion, for the time time, the set time to favor her has come. I wish I could get somebody. You got to say it even if you can't see it in the natural. You got to, it's by faith. I said this is faith month. And if you believe that this is your time that God is causing that set favor to come upon you, this is the set time. I wish I could get somebody to put their hand in the air and say, this is my time, the set time for God to favor me. I'm looking at some trouble. I'm looking at some challenges, but I'm not going to look at the challenges. I'm going to believe my God. I believe God, for he said he is shaking himself. He is arousing himself. He is moving, and because the set time to favor you has come, and I decree unto you that this month of September is the set time that God wants to favor you, his people. You got to receive it by faith. You got to believe it by faith. Don't look at your circumstance. Don't be beat down by the condition. No matter what it looks like that you're in the midst of, you decree out of your mouth that I'm going to say what God said. And God said, this is my set time. I wish I could get somebody in here. And so notice now, Jehoshaphat and the other two kings hit this place of an unusual problem. But how many of you know something? That when you hit a place of an unusual problem, God can give you an unusual directive. My God. And so he says, get me a minstrel. Elisha says, get me a minstrel. Play a little something. You know, get me some good mood music to usher in the Holy Spirit, usher in the presence. And then he starts sensing what God was saying. He said in verse 16, God's word, dig ditches all over the valley. My God, what? Dig ditches all over the valley. Here's what will happen. You won't hear the wind. You won't see the rain. But this valley is going to fill up with water, and your army and your animals will drink their fill. I wish I could get somebody who could catch it right now. I wish I could get somebody that said, my God, now this is unusual. I know I'm in a peculiar situation, but I'm a peculiar people, and I got a peculiar God who can do some unusual things in my situation. He said, dig ditches. Huh? My God, God used the prophet to tell the kings that he was getting ready to release a sweatless victory. Catch that. I said a sweatless victory. Catch it now. He said, y'all getting ready to experience a sweatless victory. Now help. I want you to understand that a sweatless victory is not an effortless victory. Huh? But it is a victory where you already have the guarantee that God was going to do it, so much so that it was going to amaze you. That's a sweatless victory. See, there's some things you've been fighting for. There's some things you've been wrestling for. There's some things that you've been sweating and scuffling, trying to get there. But God said, what I'm getting ready to do in your life now is going to be a sweatless victory. You ain't going to have to fall out. You're not going to have to wrestle. You're not going to have to fight. He said that I'm going to cause it to come upon you, and you're going to know it is God. Sweatless victory, but not effortless victory. Now understand, God loves to operate in mysterious ways, his wonders to perform. And he does still move and speak in still small voices, but there are times when he amazes you with his doings. All right? How do, my God, you take 300 men with trumpets and flashlights and overthrow a whole nation? Yet he did it with Gideon. How do you take the bottom of a meal barrel and a little bit of oil and bake a cake and then there will be an endless supply. He did it with Elijah and the widow woman. How do you march people around a wall that can't be penetrated, and then shout and the wall comes down? Yet he did it with Joshua. These were sweatless victories, but they were not effortless victories. So in other words, the directive is that I'm going to do it, but you got to dig the ditch. Is there anybody? He said, make the valley full of ditches. He says, dig the ditches and watch me move. I wish I could get two or three in here today. Now listen, this meant that every soldier, no matter his rank, no matter his position, no matter his status, no matter his length of service, every soldier was now placed on ditch duty. I wish I could get somebody. Listen, the more ditches, the more provision. I know you operate in your gifting, but it's time to dig some ditches. I know that you operate in the fivefold, but it's time to dig some ditches. I know you in the praise and worship ministry, but it's time to dig some ditches. I know you've been a part of the church and ministry for a long time, but it's time to dig some ditches. It's time, because everybody, he said all the soldiers, everybody, he said dig ditches. And see, digging a ditch did not make sense to the natural, and the soldiers must have said, here we are, we're ready to fight, we have on our wartime gear, we got our wartime strategies, and you're talking about dig ditches? You want us to dig ditches, especially where there is no forecast for rain? My God, the weatherman didn't say it was getting ready to rain. Why in the world are we digging ditches? That's why I say what you are up against right now, you don't need to hear from the weatherman. You don't need to hear from the economic indicators. You don't need to hear from the doctor. You need to hear a crazy word from God. And it might be, go ahead and dig some ditches, even when it doesn't look likely that the rain is going to come. I wish I could have somebody in here today. Huh? See, our ways are not his ways, and our thoughts are not his thoughts. This story is about faith. Only God can send the water, but he wants us to dig the ditches. You see, real faith works and believes, but be willing to start small. Do you understand that the size of your vision does not intimidate God? Do you understand that the size of what you need God to do, he's not intimidated by it? And many people don't think big enough. Ask your neighbor, do you think big? Oh, come on, about your family, in your household, concerning your walk with God, concerning the things that God has promised you, do you think big enough? Do you think, see, sometimes we look at our situation and we relegate our situation to the mind of God when we need to have the mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you which was in Christ Jesus. Jesus didn't come saying, I'm going to save a few folk. He didn't come. He said, no, I came to save that which was lost. You got to think big. Tell your neighbor, you got to think big. You got to think big. And the great thing about God is that you got to think big, but you got to start small. Huh? See, when you dig a ditch, you take one scoop at a time. Huh? I'm thinking big. I need God to do something big, but in order for me to follow the directive, I got to start out with that one little pitch of dirt. And he said, the more holes you dig, the more I'm going to fill it. I wish you could get somebody in here. Huh? God moves on his terms and not our terms. You see, God had the power to give the water, but he checks our faith and obedience. He could have just given the water, but sometimes God is watching to see if you're going to really trust him and then be obedient to what God said. See, faith in his word will cause you to put the rifle down and pick up the shovel. He said, listen, whenever you hear me, do what I say. I know that's why we miss many times, because of a lack of faith And we always complain about obeying God's command. But if they wanted the blessing of the water, then they needed to prepare to receive it. See, there was no time to look for the farmer's almanac. There was no time to try to see if the moon was full and how the water was going to come. There was no time to go and check. All they know is God sent a word, and the word was to dig ditches. If you want the blessing, you got to do what God said. Look at your neighbor today and say, neighbor, if you want the blessing, you got to do what God said. Whatever God said, do it. Huh? I'm reminded of the time when the wine ran out at the wedding at Cana of Galilee. And Mary, the mother of Jesus, said, Jesus, you got to come and help. They've run out of wine. And he said, it's before my time. And she said, listen, we need wine. And so she instructed the servants. She said, whatever he tells you to do, do it. Come on, somebody. I wish I could get two or three today who realizes that maybe I missed some things. Maybe I could have been walking in some things before, but I didn't do what God said. But I'm going back, and from now on, everything he tells me to do, I'm going to do it. You call me crazy. You call me foolish, but I'm going to hear God. And sometimes we hear people too much and miss God. I don't have anybody. Huh? See, whatever he prophetically instructs, you need to be found doing it. All right? Now understand that it was going to seem crazy. Now, let me tell you this. Digging ditches in a situation where there was a drought seemed crazy. But God said, do it, and I'll bless. Now, listen, don't do this. Don't jump out there and do something crazy and then try to say God said. No. Whatever you're doing in this season, don't do it without me. All right? So I'm not trying to figure out, God, I'm going to start this, and then I want you to join me. No, I need to discover what God is doing and join it. I wish you could get somebody. And sometimes people do a whole lot of stuff, and you step out in a whole lot of places, and you do some things, and then you want to say it's God. I was listening the other day to the radio, and I think it was Yolanda Adams. They must do this letter where they read people's issues and problems. So this letter came in. It was from this guy. He says that I've been married about 3 months, and I know that it was not a coincidence that me and my wife met each other. I know it had to be from God. I just know that. But I need a little help. He said, after 3 months, he said, I put her out 3 times. She ain't with me now. And I know it was God. I know God put us together, and I don't understand, you know, what's happening. He said, now she got a lying problem, and I got an anger problem. And we just need to know, you know, what do we do? So the first thing out of Yolanda's mouth was, you sure God? See, sometimes we say God did some stuff when it was us, and we're trying to make God affirm some mess. I don't have anybody, huh? If God said dig the ditch, dig the ditch. But don't dig the ditch, and then if God didn't say it, and then try to act like God said it. Say, you know what? I walked out in flesh. Now, God, I need your mercy and your grace. You might as well go on and call it what it is. Sometimes we try to make everything so spiritual when what we did it out of our own appetite. We did it out of our own mindset. We did it because that's what we wanted to do. That's what our lust was. Don't try to put it on God now. What you do need is God's mercy. God, I stepped out here like something crazy. God, I stepped in this direction like a fool, but I need you to come here now. I need your mercy. Please deliver me from the snare of the fowler. I need you to step in. I know you told me to go the other way. I know you told me to go left, and I went right, but now, God, I do need you, because I won't say that, God, I felt your spirit lead me. No, it was my flesh. This was of God. Tell your neighbor it's time to dig some ditches in your situation. It's time to dig some ditches for that job. It's time to dig some ditches for that promotion. It's time to dig some ditches for that financial breakthrough. It's time to praise God that the Lord said, dig the ditches. Now, notice something. This is what just blows me away. Go back to 16 there, and the message says that when you dig the ditches all over the valley, here's what will happen. You won't hear the wind. You won't see the rain. All right? Now, we understand that wind and rain is the equivalent of what? A storm. And God has allowed some victories to come by way of storms, trouble, and trials, and great challenges that produce successful outcomes. But God can give a stormless victory. My God, I told you a minute ago it was a sweatless victory. Now we see it shifted to a stormless victory. Huh? He can meet your needs and supply everything for ministry, for your life, for your family, for your marriage, for your walk with him, and he can accomplish it without a storm. See, some people don't know how to receive blessing unless it's out of trouble. Unless it's always out of difficulty. God can do it without a storm. I know that he's the God of the storm. He's the God in a storm. He's the God after the storm. He's the God before the storm. But he is going to do it so that everything and everybody connected with you will have their needs met, and that will, and they will march toward overcoming the enemy, and it will not be interrupted. I wish I could get somebody to declare my household is getting ready to go to another dimension. My church is getting ready to go to another dimension. My marketplace ministry is getting ready to go to another dimension. My God, my walk with you is going to another dimension. He says that I'm gonna double up the effort. Huh? He says, I'm gonna give you double in this situation. Huh? Sometimes we say double for your trouble. But God, notice God said, I'm gonna do two things right here. All right? Let's go back down, look somewhere around 17. I'm just gonna read beginning at 16 again. Dig ditches all over the valley. Here's what will happen. You won't hear the wind, you won't see the rain, but this valley is going to fill up with water. All right? And it's going to be enough for you, your animals, and they're going to have enough to drink. And he said, this is easy for God to do. Oh, my God. Easy. Now, notice this. He said, water is going to be provided. See. Let me tell you this, that the enemy really wants you to be so consumed with your water shortage that you forget that the devil has rebelled against God and tearing people's lives up. And so God says, I got to take care of two things. I got to double barrel this issue. He said, you're going to get water, but also I'm going to hand over Moab to you. Somebody ought to praise God right there. He said, I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to handle everything that's been coming against you. My God, y'all didn't get it yet. Huh? I'm going to bless you and open the right door, work out the situation, and I'm going to destroy and deal with everything that's been coming against you. He says that when you follow my instruction, he says, all you got to know is I'm going to provide the water, and this is easy, and I'm going to hand Moab over into your hands. Now, notice, verse number 20. Let me quickly hurry. In the morning, it was at the hour of morning sacrifice. The water had arrived, water pouring in from west, from Edom. A flash flood filled the valley with water. Somebody say, I need a flash flood filling. Fa, fa, fa. Flash flood feeling. Come on, somebody. The writer got alliterative. He said, I need a flash flood feeling. Come on, say it on this side. A flash flood feeling. Say it over here. A flash flood feeling. Now shout about it right there. I'm getting ready to get a flash flood. Now, I noticed that the interesting thing is that this water began to fill the ditches, and it was at the time of morning worship. It was at the time of offering sacrifice. Now understand, this was a systematic part of the life of God's people. At the morning offering, that the blessing came. Sowing into the kingdom means benefits from the benefactor. Isn't that right? Now notice, we got to understand that it came at a time when they were worshiping, when they were sowing, and when they were giving the sacrifice. It was during the morning sacrifice that the ditches filled up, the people's needs were met. But that was a light thing. God is phenomenal, and God had predetermined, he had prearranged intentions, and he said, I'm going to do it. And I got to tell somebody today that you're going to see it just in the natural process of your going about worshiping God, and as you continue to have the relationship with him, you're going to notice that your ditches are going to be filled, and you're going to notice that there was no rain. It didn't say anything about rain coming. It didn't say anything about the wind blowing. It didn't say anything about thunder clashing, but he said all of a sudden they woke up and the ditches were filled. And since the ditches were filled, my God, everybody was throwing water everywhere. Can you look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, get ready to throw some water. Get ready to throw some water on your situation. Get ready to wet your lips with what God said I'm going to do. I won't have anybody who can get ready. Y'all don't believe it? So you're so stuck on where you are right now that I can feel the rain. I can feel the rain. Somebody say, I can feel the rain. I feel it. I feel the water. I feel the water. I feel it. It's wet. He says, I'm doing it in your favor. Now here, as I close this thing out now, he said, double for your trouble. Doo-wop. Now go over to verse 21. Man. See, what's going to happen now? God is going to cause an optical illusion. Verse 21, by this time, everyone in Moab had heard that the kings had come up to make war against them. Everyone who was able to handle a sword was called into service and took a stand at the border. The enemy heard that you were coming, and they were ready. They were up and ready early in the morning when the sun rose over the water. Now remember, the ditches all over the land, they were filled with water. Watch God, watch God. Filled with water. And as the sun rose over the water, from where the Moabites stood, the water reflecting the sun looked like red blood. Optical illusion. Verse 23, blood. Look at the blood. This is what the Moabites were saying. The kings must have fought each other a bloody massacre. They said, go for the loot, Moab. My God, I wish you could get somebody that the enemy thought you were down and out. The enemy thought that all the wind was out of your sail. The enemy thought that you had come against your own selves. But he says, listen, God's got something for the enemy. So the enemy comes in. And they thought that the Israelite king and the king of Judah and the king of Edom had come against themselves. So they rose up and said, let's go plunder. Let's go get everything they had. They threw their weapons down. And don't you know that God would cause to drop your weapon, cause the enemy to drop his weapon? As a matter of fact, somebody ought to say, Satan, in the name of the Lord, I command you to drop your weapon right now. Everything that's been warring against me, I decree that you got to drop it right now. And so they came in and they dropped their weapons. They were ready to go in and pick up all the spoils, but they didn't realize that they were getting ready to be turned upside down. Sometimes God will allow the enemy to perceive that there is defeat only to raise you up. Somebody say, God's getting ready to raise you up. Huh? It looked like defeat in your situation. It looked like your family had struggled and struck out. It looked like you were at bat and you messed up. It looked like because you went through that financial storm, because you went through that job loss, that everything was over. It looked like because you had to file for bankruptcy. It looked like because you had a business to fail, the enemy thought that you were done. He stuck a fork in you, but the fork wouldn't go because you were not defeated. God's going to raise you up. So when the enemy came in, God lifted up a standard, and the people of God beat them back so much so until everything the prophet said came to pass. The king of Moab realized his defeat, all because the people of God moved out on what God instructed them to do. It was a simple matter for a big God. I wish I could get somebody here today. It was beyond human explanation, and God is declaring today that it's time to dig some ditches by faith. What he's getting ready to do is going to be so wonderful that you will have to declare that it is the Lord's doing. What God wants to do in your situation, you're going to have to declare that it's a simple matter for a big God. Start digging ditches through prayer. And every prayer you pray is a ditch. Every time you pray, it's another ditch. Every time you fast, it's another ditch. Every time you sow a seed, it's another ditch. Every time you follow the word, it's another ditch. Every time you declare by faith the word of God, it is another ditch. Every time you step out on the word, it is another ditch. God wants to fill your ditches. Is there anything too hard for God? I know sometimes it does not make sense, but put your trust in God. He is a big God. Somebody say, he's a big God. It seems major for us, but it's simple for God. He is a big God. Somebody say, a big God. Our God is a big God. Bigger than all your problems. He's bigger than all your fears. He's bigger than all your mountains. He's bigger than what I can and cannot see. Don't tell God how big your issue is, but tell your issue how big your God is. Is there anybody in here who would declare how great is our God? Our God is a big God. He's big enough to save the whole world with one act at Calvary. He was big enough to let Jesus hang in the noonday sun to save a dying world. He was big enough to let him die. And even though they put him in a borrowed tomb, he was big enough not to worry. Even though he stayed there Friday night, he wasn't worried. Even though he stayed there Saturday night, he wasn't worried, because he was big enough. Though the enemy said it was over, though the devil and the enemy was having a high-five party, they said, we got him now, and we've gotten rid of this Jesus. But I'm so glad that our big God, early Sunday morning, before the dew was on the roses, early Sunday morning, before the bird came out for the worm, early Sunday morning, before the robin stepped out of her nest and began singing praises to the God, early Sunday morning, God raised Jesus up. And since he raised Jesus up, he said, all power is in my hand. I can destroy, but I will defend. Our God is great. High five your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's a simple matter for a big God. If your God is too small, try mine. If your God is dead, try mine. If your God is weak, try mine. The greatness of the Lord is inconceivable. The love that he shows is unconditional. The power of the Lord is unimaginable. Great is the God we serve. God is great and greatly to be praised. Greatness of the Lord is inconceivable. Is there anybody in here who's tried our great God? Is there anybody in here who's put their trust in the Lord? I'm so glad that you might call me crazy, but I'm gonna trust in the Lord until I die. I'm gonna stay on the battlefield until I die, because I heard my God when he said, I'll make the darkness light before thee. Whatever is wrong, I'll make it right before thee. All your battles I will fight before thee, and the high places will come down. Whenever you walk along the way, he said, I'll lead you on the fatness of the land. I'll feed you, and a mansion in the sky I'll deed thee, and the high places I will bring down. With an everlasting love I'll love thee, and through trials great and sore I'll prove thee. There is nothing that can shake or move thee, and the high places, hey, 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 I said the high places will come down. Though you walk through the valley, he said, I'll be with you. Though you walk through the flood, I'll be with you. And I know sometimes it seems like he allowed men to ride over your head. I know sometimes it seemed like he brought you through the valley, and it seemed like he purged you like gold and silver. But he said, I did it. I allowed it so I could bring you out in to your wealthy place. Is there anybody here who understands that your situation is a simple matter for a big God? He's bigger than big, greater than great. Say yes. Say yes. Try him in every situation. It's a small matter. It's a small matter for a big God. Let me tell you something. All the issues that we're dealing with in life, all the issues that we are faced and in our country, domestically, the issues in Syria, the issues in Israel, all those are simple matters for a big God. God's not surprised by the economy. God's not surprised by the wickedness in the world. Simple things. Simple matter for a big God.